So hello everyone. I guess this is the last talk, so I am in a bit of a difficult position because everyone hates the last speaker. I am the person who is standing between you and taking rest. All the organizers, they must already be thinking, once he gets off stage, it's all done, completed, done. We are good to go. And all the audience are already tired of all the information you are getting for the last 2 days. Also, it's difficult because any talk after Bradley Kuhn is difficult to give on free and open source. So he already put on a lot of points, and I do agree with most of them. I actually met Bradley in FOSSDEM this year. So Bradley and Karen Sandler did give a keynote on something called how they're an free software activist, but they still fail to always use free software. So do watch that keynote. It's really good. It's in YouTube. You can always go and watch. So I'll try not to take like a lot of time and not to go deep into, like not go at all into code, because you already have a lot of information to gather. So I'll try to just talk about, you know, nothing about code, but more about you. So starting off with me, I guess she already gave a good enough introduction. So I'm primarily a developer, but I've been doing open source since for 6 years now, I think. And with open source comes this contribution to community as well. It's not only about code. It's like Bradley said, it was like a movement. So it's still a movement. So community comes in as a part of it. So free and open source. How many of you have heard this term, free and open source, before? OK. How many of you know what this term means? OK, so slightly lesser hands. So some of you still don't understand. That's good. So I'll try to end the like FOSSMeet with a talk in a little optimistic way rather than a pessimistic way. So you all are still encouraged to do free and open source, because that's, after all, the purpose of FOSSMeet. So yeah, free and open source. I guess many of you will recognize some of the icons that you might have used in one of your projects. So even if you don't know what it is, you definitely have used it. You can pretty much be sure about it. So what does free and open source include? So free and open source, like Bradley said a lot many times, it includes four things: copy, share, change, and improve suggestions. So copy or access code, what it means is you have access to the entire source code. You can check the entire source code. You can copy any part of the source code. Like someone was asking in a question when A-frame was asked, like, is a particular function also open source? Yeah, the entire code is open source. So you can basically see the logic, how it's implemented. You can reuse the logic of how it's implemented, and you can go about it, right? Understanding code. So understanding code always helps you to, you know, you getting better in how the things work. So there was a time when cryptographers would never, ever share the algorithms during the times of World War II, because they felt that if someone already understood how their code works, then it's bad. But what happened in that was a lot of encryption was actually blocked, like a lot of improvement in encryption was blocked, because no one was sharing with each other what they know. So there wasn't a collaborative development, right? So understanding code, sharing of code helps with that. Then comes modifying code. So what do I mean by modifying code? There can be different ways of modifying code. So something, again, that we have been talking about, copyleft license, and then like all these licenses. So licenses play an important role in telling you how you can actually modify the code. It's not like if you know that, OK, this code is in GitHub and I can see the source code, I can pretty much do anything with it. It's not exactly that. You can do to a great extent, but you should know and study more about licensing if you are actually thinking of modifying the code and using it in your own project. So there are like different kind of licensing. There is an enforcing license like GPL and others, and then there are like more non-enforcing licenses like MIT or Apache. So even when you are writing your own project, you should always have a license for your open source project, because that also ensures to some extent that you can actually fight against someone if they're using your code in a wrong way that you don't want it to be. So it's very important for you to understand like which license you should be using in your own project. So that is completely determined by what you want your project to be used for, how you want your project to be modified and used, right? And then comes suggest modifications or improvements. So suggest modifications and improvement is, I feel, the best part about free and open source, because that helps you in improving a code that already exists. So Linux might not have been Linux if it wasn't open source, right? Because it was a hobby project. Everything starts off, many of the open source projects actually start off as a hobby project. But being open source, people start contributing to it, right? Many of us feel that, okay, these open source projects are not as good as the proprietary project. Maybe, but then the good thing about it is you can actually go and improve the project. You can do the same for the proprietary things. Like Bradley said, in back old days, even now if you want an improvement in a proprietary project, you would actually need to, you know, call up the vendor and ask them to fix it for you. Or like for Microsoft, you have to wait for another Windows operating system, which is not coming anymore. So yeah, but then for open source projects, you can always go and see, okay, if this is a bug that I see, okay, maybe I don't understand, but I know a kernel developer who can fix it. So you can go and tell, hey, can you look into this bug? Maybe he or she would be interested in it. So yeah. So a good example I gave of open source versus like non-open source is Internet Explorer versus Chromium. How many of you are Linux users here? Okay. So thankfully, you don't have to deal with Internet Explorer anyway, so good thing. So all proprietary software is something like this. You don't have access to the source code. So this is a slide from a talk which was given by Richard Stallman a few years back in FOSSDEM. So this is basically what happens when you don't have the freedom in coding, right? So it's more like the software has control over you than you having control over the software. You don't get to decide what you do with the software. The software rather decides what they do with you. And it's like, it sounds creepy and it is creepy, because most of the time when you are using proprietary software, you, even like using an app like Facebook Messenger in your phone, you don't really know what it's actually doing with your phone. You think, okay, I've closed the app, that's all, but that's not all. They might be listening to you all the time. They might be tracking where you are exactly at this point of time. And they provide this data to all other people. So that's how their business model works. And that's not a very good thing, right? So that's what happens in a very non-open source proprietary world. But when you are doing an open source contribution, it's more like you have a control over it. You can actually go and see through the open source code and realize what probably they're doing. If you don't like what they're doing, you can actually go and copy the code and deploy your own thing if you have that kind of infrastructure with you. So it's a freedom, it's a choice that you have what you do, and it's not like someone having a control over you. I guess most of these things you already know, but then, like I said, I want to emphasize on why open source is cool and maybe end on an optimistic note. So why contribute? So this, I guess, again, is something most people know who are contributors. How many of you contribute to some kind of open source project? That's a fair enough number. So collaboration, right? Collaboration is something which most people contribute for, right? Because in a collaborative environment, there's always a greater chance of learning. There's a greater chance of the product ending being better than what you would have done sitting in a closed room without collaborating with everyone. Self-development. This is something I feel is very important when you are at a very young state like me or anyone who is there in this university studying still. Because right now what happens in universities, at least in India, is most of the things that you learn are learning from the books very theoretically, right? But then theory is very difficult from practical. And it doesn't only apply for coding, right? You can know how exactly you are supposed to swim. Like, you know, you have to put your head down, take a deep breath, but throw yourself into a swimming pool, it's a complete different scenario. So same happens with coding as well, right? So you more you get to do like contributions into a project which is there in the open world, which everyone is using, there's always a chance of self-development. You get to know things you might not have ever thought would happen. Contributions. So contributions are always good. It's a way of giving back to the community. So once you feel that you are good enough, or even if you don't feel. So many people think that open source is only about coding, right? And many people are deterred by this fact that, okay, I don't know Java, so maybe I won't be contributing to this project. Or I don't know Python, so I won't be contributing. Or I don't know good enough to contribute to a project. Well, the thing is, you can go and just do documentation. That is a good enough contribution for an open source project. Documentation is one of the most important contributions, because documentation also happens to be one of the strong points of an open source project. You know exactly what and how and everything. Similarly, many of people in open source whom I know started their contribution by translations. So most of the open source projects have some way of doing translation so that it's available all over the world and not to just few of the people who know English very well. So you can do different kind of contribution. It doesn't have to be coding all the time. Sharing. So as your mother taught one day, sharing is caring. So yeah, always sharing helps, I guess. Community. So being in FOSSMeet, you're already a part of community. And I guess with the community, it also helps you grow. With the growth of the community, you grow with it. So community forms an important part of open source world altogether. And opportunities. And why I say opportunities here is because most of you might be college students. So that's one of the main things. At least when I was in college, most of my friends were only concerned with, okay, I will do open source if I get job from it. Well, you might not directly get a job in that organization where you were contributing, but then what happens is if you are doing contributions, you have a good enough resume. Like if you contribute to, let's say, a Python project like Flask and you have good enough Python contribution, then it kind of guarantees that you have some understanding of Python. They won't be asking, okay, how to print Hello World in Python in your interview, right? So that opens up opportunities. You will get a bigger hand in that. And also it opens up opportunities in a sense, like coming to FOSSMeet, you could hear Bradley Kuhn, but if there wasn't open source, you might not have ever heard him, right? So that's kind of the thing. Like, this gives you the opportunity to learn from people who are not in your exact geographical locations. You can learn from many other people's. And yeah, very important for everyone. So benefit as a student, like I am concentrating again and again in students because I guess most of the other people who have already graduated and still in open source, they have already figured out why contribution and how contribution and all the things. But students are always in a dilemma, like, should I be doing contribution or should I be focusing on studying for Google Code Jam or something like that, right? So unbounded learning, that's similar to what I was talking about opportunities, right? Most of the learning that we have is from the university professors. And I'm not saying that they don't know anything, but then it's limited to a geographical condition, right? You can't know from everyone. Like, but in open source, you can actually go and talk with the guy who started Python. That's the fun of it. You can log into IRC CPython channel and you can talk with Guido. So that kind of thing happens. You get an unbounded learning. You don't have to be restricted by only what is provided to you by the university or what your parents decided 4 years ago for you. You can have unbounded learning from anywhere in the world. Professional interactions. Why do I say professional interactions is when you contribute to open source projects, the interactions won't be like, okay, this looks good, but this is not going to fetch you good marks in your exam. It's going to be a professional interaction in a way, like many of the questions that we had, those were like professional interactions. Okay, is this looks good, but is this very suitable in an environment like he was talking about the drone environment or like, whether it's like deployable in a project, it sounds good, but whether it's actually readable, can people reuse it? So those are kind of the professional interactions that you're gonna have when you do open source contributions, right? Outside opportunities, again. Understanding of computing. So there is something like learning how an operating system works and what is like paging and everything, and then going into the Linux kernel and actually seeing how it does, or like knowing how a web framework should be written or how a server works, and going into Flask and see how Flask runs a server. So that's a very different thing. That's exactly how you understand how actually the computings are and how you are learning. So you're learning most of the projects that we write till first year, second year is basically something like a piece of code that runs, give me the output, good marks, A+, done. But computing is much more than that, right? It's about working good with the entire project, the ecosystem, the infrastructure that you have. So it comes on, it brings in a lot of different factors. And for the fun of it, so that's a very important slide, actually. Like most of the projects that you do, when it's enforced on you, you lose the fun in it. Like I love history, but when history was a subject, I hated it because I have to remember all the dates. So when you do it for fun, that's one of the things that open source helps you. You do just for the sake of fun. You don't do it for anything else. Just do for the sake of fun because it's really fun. You can actually, means if it's not the kind of fun that you want, it's completely your choice, but then it's fun in a way if you're interested into coding. You actually get to interact with like a lot many people and create very cool stuff which you might not be doing. And you can actually select any project that you want. There are like millions of open source projects. So you can select your project by your choice. Something that I often tell my juniors when they ask me is like, select the project that you use mostly. Like if you are using Linux, you are actually using a lot many open source projects, right? So select the project that you maybe use mostly. Let's say you use Firefox all the time and you find Firefox fascinating. So you can go and actually contribute to Firefox. That's kind of fun to me. Now, if all these things doesn't like convince you that open source is great and real and it's not how Trump thinks about global warming, then I'll throw some few statistics at you. I know you heard a lot of negative things about GitHub repos, but it still happens to be one of the platforms which hosts the largest number of like open source projects. So kind of throwing that status anyways. So there are like 96 plus million active GitHub repositories, which are like public repositories. This is a statistics of 2018. 78% of the companies actually run open source. So the principles are okay, very different. I get like, we already heard about the negative parts, but the good thing like he said was that at least the companies are starting to adopt open source and free software at the first place. So 78% companies at least run open source. So even if you go to a proprietary software, most of the servers will be running Linux anyways, right? 92% of the applications contain open source libraries. So even when you're using an app like, let's say, or a website of Swiggy, or you are using a website of, let's say, Zoomcar or Uber or any other proprietary software, they have a bunch of open source tools that they're using, right? They're probably using a Python or Go or Java or PHP in their backend, all of which happen to be open source. They are using some kind of JavaScript library in the front end, let's say it be React or it be jQuery. Those all are open source libraries. So most of the applications that you see, even if they're proprietary, they will be using some kind of open source libraries in that, right? So 92% of them still do that. And there's a $140 billion economic value that open source provides. And that's the sad story, kind of. Like, it provides this kind of money, but it's concentrated on the few things. Like he was saying, it should be more distributed, the money, rather than being concentrated on just few people. So that's exactly what happens. 62% of the projects are self-funded. So most of the open source libraries, like jQuery, so jQuery is not self-funded anymore, but many of the open source projects are self-funded, right? We are going to see some of the examples. So what happens is these companies are making millions of dollars out of it, but these projects go and end up to be self-funded. So is this a sustainable thing? It's not. How many of you have heard about semantic UI? Okay, so I guess some of the front-end developers would. So semantic UI, I do encourage everyone who hasn't used semantic UI and always use Bootstrap to check this out, because it kind of makes your website don't look always Twitter. So semantic UI was created by this guy. So if you see, so star kind of helps you to understand, it gives you a bit of an understanding like how famous this project is or how many people might be using this. So this has like this many stars, which is, I don't know if it's visible, but it's almost 41,000, right? But then it has an issue called asymmetric UI development dead. And this is what he replied. I'm again not sure if it's visible, but it says that basically he has been working a lot on semantic UI, but just working on semantic UI isn't very sustainable for him. It doesn't provide him any financial benefits whatsoever. So maybe a principal problem, yes, but then again, it's also a sustainability problem, right? Anyone know about this incident? Anyone, any JavaScript developers over here? No JavaScript developers? Everyone afraid of security? Okay. So this is a very interesting and very famous thing that happened last year. So what happened is this guy was basically, like, this guy started this project called Event Stream, which most of the NPM libraries kind of use. But he wasn't able to sustain himself just by doing it. So he stopped maintaining this project. The project is still there. You can go ahead and use it. But he wasn't maintaining the modules whatsoever. So one fine day, this guy turns up and says, hey, can you, like, I am interested in this project. Can you give me the permissions and everything? And I'll maintain the project for you. And he's like, sure, why not? Go ahead. So he gives him all the permissions and everything. And what happens is this guy introduces a vulnerability to the project. And now what happens is all the node libraries that were using this project kind of starts breaking down. All right. Now, the good thing about open source, if you notice here, is this thing got noticed within not even a day. Right. So not even a day, people found out that there is this vulnerability. They filed this issue. There was this huge debate of what he should have done and what's not going wrong. But finally, it got fixed within a day. So that's the great thing about open source again. This is a tweet that came out in January, if you can see January 18, 2019. So this is a very funny tweet. How many of you have heard about ESLint? Okay. So if you use JavaScript and don't use linting, that's very sad. But yeah, this is another story. So this is a conversation at least I have had with my parents. I don't know if you all have, but it's like, means, so this is the creator of ESLint, basically, Jackass. So his mom says that, okay, I know that you are like creator of one of the big projects. How many people do use that? And he says, mostly everyone who uses JavaScript. And so his mom is like, so how much do you make out of it? And he is like, nothing. So mom is like, I don't understand your industries. Neither do I. So should open source be free? So it depends on how you talk about free. I shouldn't have mentioned beer, maybe. But yeah, it's like you should think it as a form of freedom. It's what they call in like libre, not gratis, right? So it's about freedom. You have the freedom to access the code. You have the freedom to deploy this code. But it doesn't mean that the code itself, like the service they provide via that code, has to be free all the time. So this is some jargon I'll skip. OK. So coming to one of the solutions, there are obviously many different solutions. But since I happen to work as like one of their developers and I previously contributed to the project, so this is one of the solutions that's been quite good and out there. So the problem, as you might have understood, and as even Bradley said, is sustainability. How do you sustain yourself just by doing open source? Because mostly you are not going to make any money out of it, right? So that's a problem that Gitcoin is trying to solve. So the solution is kind of like, since the sustainability problem is in both sides, right? The maintainers have this sustainability problems because, see, a big enough library like Semantic UI just has one maintainer, which means there are no active contributors all the time. If we had an active contributor, then they could have also been a maintainer. So what happens is many of the many talented developers don't feel like doing open source contributions. So that kind of harms the maintainers. And again, the contributors don't do because they can't sustain from themselves, right? So it's kind of like you give them something, you take back something. So this is kind of the scenario that we have been looking. It kind of collides with one of the ideas that a guy said, that we should always have a hierarchy. Okay, that's a debate I'll take offline. But what we are thinking in Gitcoin is something like a completely decentralized kind of work, right? So it doesn't have to be that you are working in a particular company. You can work for several other companies, and even if you have your own open source project, you can go ahead and contribute to another open source project. Nothing is stopping you from doing that. So the job scenario should probably look something like this in future, so that everyone else can contribute to every other project. And that way, everything gets distributed. Probably the financial things would also get distributed. So just to give a demo, and I'm not going to go to any website link because that's not a good idea. Demo gods never trust me. So this is an example page of Gitcoin Explorer. So what happens is it's kind of like finding a work, and it's always an open source work. So you can go ahead and see that there are open source issues. So there are issues in open source project which people would actually fund. So it can be your project, it can be a project, let's say, someone who has a lot of money, say they are interested in getting a particular bug fixed in a particular open source project, and they don't mind really funding it. So they can go ahead and fund that project, and what happens is when a contributor comes and completes the project, they get whatever the funding amount is from there, right? So benefits of contributions are almost same as contributing to open source. So yeah, so the steps are pretty simple. What you do is you select any of the bounties that is there in this list. You will be taken to a page like this where you get a description, which is currently, so we are currently integrated with GitHub. We are trying to integrate it with different other platforms. But yeah, right now what it happens is it takes out the description that's there in the GitHub issue description, and you can see it over there. You can also go and view the issue on GitHub for seeing all the conversations that have already happened on the issue. And you can click Start Work. So the contribute button here actually is something about contributing to the funding, not to the code. So Start Work. So Start Work basically will allow you to like give, you know, like start on a particular project depending on how the bounty is designed. And after that, it's pretty much what you are doing in open source contribution right now. So if you are doing open source contribution already, you are already clear of the flow of how you go to a GitHub issue, talk in the channel, whether it be on IRC or Gitter or Slack or whatever. Then you submit a pull request after discussing whatever your approach is. Then there are pull request reviews. You go to and fro. Pull request gets merged. So that's the entire open source part where Gitcoin doesn't interfere at all. So you do whatever you have been already doing. It's just that you now have a platform where you can find the issues that you might find suitable to contribute to. After your pull request gets merged, this is the link to the bounty submission page. So you go ahead, click on the submit work, you put the pull request link, and then you get paid. OK, so the twist, as the title of my talk suggested, was like sustaining on open source via blockchain. So yeah, this entire transaction happens over the Ethereum network. So you get paid in ERC20 tokens. Now at this point, all of you who were interested might be thinking, no more interested because India has banned blockchain altogether. Yes and no. India has banned blockchain as in you can't buy blockchain with your money, you can't put the blockchain amount or whatever the cryptocurrency back to your money. So if you have like if you want to buy 2 bitcoins, it's really difficult for you to do that. Also, if you have 2 bitcoins and you want to put it back into like money, it's really difficult for you to do that. But thinking again in another way, Indian government doesn't stop you to do transactions via blockchain, right? So if you do have 2 Bitcoin and there is a platform where you can go and use Bitcoin, or let's say Ethereum, because it's in the Ethereum network, so all the ERC20 tokens. So if you have, let's say, 2 Ethereum or you have 2 DAI or whatever, and a platform allows you to use this blockchain like cryptocurrencies, then this is one of your best ways to earn cryptocurrencies in India. So if you, even if you want to like hold cryptocurrencies, which many people do, like hoping that the winter will go away, though the winter is coming. But yeah, so you can actually earn from here. If you want to hold, you can hold. there are many platforms like Gitcoin which are coming up, which actually allows you to use your cryptocurrencies to get things done. So that's also one of the reasons for making it on blockchain is there are a lot of cryptocurrencies, but there aren't that many platforms where you can go and use it. So there's this ideology of distributed hyperledger and everything, but then there's no proper application where you're actually going to use it. And until and unless you have places where you're going to use it, what are you going to do with it? So that's one of the reasons why Gitcoin doesn't have its own token. We allow you to use any ERC20 tokens that you want. You can actually come and spend and earn and spend and earn and do whatever you want. You can even earn and then spend to like fund a issue in your own project if you want to take your project to a good level, right? So this kind of was the answer to the contributor parts. Now, many of you might be maintainers. Are there any open source project maintainers over here? OK, few. So right. So many of the open source project maintainers, like we saw even for Semantic UI, the problem is that they don't have a way of sustaining themselves or sustaining the project, so as to say. So I know a few of the open source contributors or like open source developers. So if you have heard a developer called Pharos, so he left his job. He's a great JavaScript developer, but he left all his jobs. And what he does is he does make just open source projects altogether. So he keeps making open source projects, and he has a Patreon account. And if someone goes and like contributes to his Patreon account, well and good. Otherwise, he doesn't earn anything. But Gitcoin Grants is completely focused towards developers. So it's kind of like Patreon, but it's focused completely to developers. So if you have an open source project, you can actually go and, or it's also, you can draw another analogy like Kickstarter website, right? So you can go and like submit your project, and then people contribute to the amount that you think that you need for a year or whatever be the case. And once you like meet that amount after the contributions, you get the payment every month. So it's a subscription-based model. It's, if anyone is like a blockchain geek, you can go through the EIP 1337 standard. It's the subscription protocol in ERC20 tokens. So that's Gitcoin Grants. And another thing that we have is kudos, because why not? Because appreciation is something that I guess always like strives development in open source. That's what most of the people look for in open source projects, more than, or should be looking for maybe, but at least when I started with open source projects, if I contributed to Flask and Armin Ronaher came and said, hey, good job on that pull request, that was all I needed, right? So this is an appreciation system where you can give badges. Each badge has a name and a picture attached to it. It is also a token called NFT, non-fungible token. So basically, it's kind of a gift that you give. Obviously, you can sell out a gift that your friend gave and take the money out of it, which most probably you don't do. So maybe you shouldn't be doing with this. But then the thing is, like, if you get a kudos from someone who is a really great developer in that project, it kind of makes a lot of meanings. And when someone visits your profile page, they can actually see like all the badges that you have and who gave you that badge. So I guess the who gave part also makes a lot of difference, right? So this is all the entire thing. Like I promise, I won't be taking a lot of time because this is the last talk and that's what is stopping you from going out of this room. So these are a few of the reference links. I'll share the slide at the end of the talk on my Twitter, so you can go and see all these links. And yeah, open to questions.
So now is a question and answer session. Anyone has any questions?
Can I ask a question? Yep. I might have missed out because I was outside in between. So I was just wondering about the business model where you say that, let's say if I have an idea that I want to build a software and I want to make it open source. Right now it seems that if you are a powerful or a big organization, they can easily start out a project. They have the investment to start out a project and make it open source right away. They can still survive. But what if I am just, I don't have any other way of sustaining it and I just want to start a project and it should be open source right from the first. And I want to live out of it. I'm not sure if I could do it as a hobby project. You see, then hobby projects grow into sources of income, but is there a business model where I can start out a project as an open source project? And
so it kind of depends on the project, right? So Wikipedia did pretty good with Wikimedia. They made a business model out of it. They're making a bunch of money out of it. Mozilla has been sustaining themselves pretty fine with all the projects they have. So one of the very common business models that most of the open source projects follow is, like, you have the open source project. Let's say Firefox, for example. Though Firefox is free, but you have the open source project. Now, people are free to go and download that open source project and deploy on their own. But how many people do you think would want to do that? But many consumers would want to use a managed system, right? So what many people do, like WordPress does, is they have WordPress, which is open source. So you can download WordPress, have your own server, deploy your own WordPress, and then write your own blogs. Works perfectly. But then most of the bloggers won't have that infrastructure or the knowledge to do that. So now WordPress provides this as a managed service, right? So that's one of the common ways that many of the people do. Another thing where many of the cases you won't actually be able to do that, like things where, let's say, if you're making an open source framework, so how do you do with an open source framework? Most probably you won't be able to make money. So that's something which we kept in mind and made Gitcoin grants. So Gitcoin grants was focused towards that. Yes, you won't be making money as you might have made in a multi-billionaire company, right? But means you won't be able to make that kind of investment, but that's a kind of starting to sustaining yourselves. Now, if you can like grow on top of that and sustain yourself via grants, then things start working out and you do that. Right.
You mentioned about you giving the Bitcoins, right? Once the project issue is finished.
Not Bitcoin, Ethereum or ERC20 tokens.
Okay, so for example, if I want to, I want to finish some issue. I want to create an issue and give some money. Mm-hmm. How should I pay it?
Okay, so right now the way is, like, there are two ways you can do that, right? So firstly, what we do is, if you have your own, like, you are willing to pay on your own, then you have to have the cryptocurrencies. Okay, so that's the thing. The second way is, there is something called Gitcoin requests. So what happens in Gitcoin requests is, we have some amount of funding from Ethereum Foundation themselves. So you can go and say that, okay, this is an issue that I want to fund, but I don't have any cryptocurrencies or even money to fund it. And you put the request, and then the team goes through it, and then if they think that it's good enough, they will fund it for you. So these are the two ways that we have for funding right now. So if you are willing to pay your own money, then it's like you have to have blockchain for that, like any ERC20 token for that. You can pay in any ERC20 token. It doesn't have to be Ethereum. No Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is not programmable. Bitcoin is just a cryptocurrency on a blockchain network. Ethereum network is very different. It allows something like smart contract, where you can track the transactions. You can do transactional computations and do stuff with it. So Bitcoin allows you. Bitcoin is basically just another alternative to banking system. But Ethereum network can allow, it's basically just a technological stack. It's just like using a PostgreSQL database. You can make a choice of using that, or you can make a choice of Ethereum network. Or basically, it's a technological stack, just like you decide what kind of database you want to use. So one of the alternatives is using the Ethereum network altogether. So it's programmable. You can make different products out of it. It doesn't have to be anything about money. You can still make out of it. Right.